I have been doing over the past years many times the thing you are doing right now, attending a workshop on computational methods. And there is one memory I want to share with you. It was a workshop a few years ago where we had on the first day a few quite interesting introductory lectures. And then third lecture of the day, more or less, the lecturer springs on stage and says, well, I've realized that in the past lectures you have seen not a single equation yet. So let's do some real work and do the mathematics. And you guess what happened? 5 minutes later, the audience was completely lost and nobody had anything valuable in that lecture. So that's what I will try to avoid. You will have almost no mathematics in this lecture. I will try to stick to concepts. Now, I have a clear goal in this lecture, and that goal is visualized in this slide here. This is a snapshot from a paper that uses computational methods. And snapshots like this, you will find many of them in the literature. So let's read through that first sentence, word by word. See what we have there. The electronic structure calculations in this paper are performed within the DFT framework using the projector augmented wave PAW approach for the core valence interaction and the Purdue-Burke-Ernsterhof approximation for the exchange correlation functional as implemented in the VASP code. What do you feel if you read that sentence? Think about that, because I will ask you. I will give you three possibilities. Either you think, well, I feel comfortable with that sentence. I could have written that myself, no problem. Or you feel, I recognize some of the words that appear there, but if you would ask me what these words mean, I would have a problem. Or you say, well, this could as well has been written in Swahili. I would have understood as much as I do now. So just to know who is sitting here in front of me, raise your hand for each of these categories. Who feels comfortable with that previous sentence? I count at least one, yeah, two, yeah. So a few people. So who is in the middle category? About one half, and who is in the third category, which is no shame at all, the other half. Okay. Well, the main message of this lecture will be for the people who are in these two categories. I apologize to the experts, but it's not useless for the experts to be in the audience because I will consider them as my sparring partners. If I make any mistake in the conversion from mathematics to concepts, then you are the ones that will have to correct me. So for the other two categories, I will try to tell the story about DFT, but in different ways. I will tell you three times the same story. I will explain DFT three times, starting from scratch every time again. So after every 10 minutes, you can forget what you heard before and start all over again. Every time, I will emphasize a slightly different aspect of DFT, and I hope that by taking these three pictures together, you will have a good understanding of what DFT means. And by doing so, we will be able, in the end of this lecture, to understand that sentence from the paper we have just read. But before I can start the explanation about DFT, we have to know what is the beast we need to tame. What is the problem we want to solve? And you already heard something about it in the previous hour. That problem is now a solid which is a collection of nuclei, here indicated in red, with capital letters for the position vectors, and electrons, indicated in blue, with lowercase symbols for the position vectors. That solid, that abstract solid, that we want to compute, we want to predict all properties of that solid that can be measured in the lab. We know what are the interactions that are relevant for that solid, and these were these five categories that also appeared in the previous hour. From top to bottom, we have the kinetic energy of the nuclei. They move, so they have kinetic energy. Second set of terms, kinetic energy for the electrons. Then the nuclei are Coulomb interacting with each other. Third set of terms, the electrons are Coulomb interacting with each other. And the electrons are Coulomb interacting with the nuclei. That's what's going on in any solid. The behavior of that solid, that is described by the wave function, the many-body wave function psi, which can be found by solving the Schrödinger equation. So that is our beast. We have to solve that Schrödinger equation. We have to find that many-body wave function psi. And if we can do that, we know everything that ever can be known about that solid. I use the word wave function, and we say that easily, but that word function has a strict mathematical meaning. So let's go back to very basic mathematics and see whether we understand that the wave function really is a function in the mathematical sense. So I put here a definition of what you learned many years ago in school about a function. So it's a map that connects a domain set, here the real numbers, with a target set. Every number from the left-hand set is mapped to a number in the right-hand set. That's a function. The wave function is a function as well. So we need to identify what is the domain set of the wave function and what is the target set of the wave function. And let's do that for a specific example. I take a two-particle system without spin. Forget spin, it's always making troubles. Just two particles, spinless particles. For that two-particle system, I need to find the many-body, here the two-body wave function. What would be the domain set? What would be the target set? I will give you four possibilities. From R3 to C2, from R6 to C2, from R6 to C, or from C6 to C. Take half a minute to think about this. Which of the four options would be the solution to that question? Who thinks it's A? I see no hands. Who thinks it's B? A few hands, so from R6 to C2. Who thinks it's C? Quite more than one half of the audience. And who thinks it's D? Nobody. So, but most people think it's C, which is indeed the right answer. You have two particles without spin, so only spatial degrees of freedom. One particle can move in three dimensions, that's 3 degrees of freedom. The second particle also moves in 3 dimensions, that's another 3 degrees of freedom. And the value of a wave function is always one complex number, so that's just C. So two spinless particles go from R6 to C. That's the map that is made by the wave function. Now I will start my explanations of DFT 3 times. And so the first attempt will be a story. I start that story from the Large Hadron Collider in CERN. And what you see here is a picture of one of the detectors in that machine, the ATLAS detector. It's taken during the construction process of the detector, so you cannot see this picture anymore live right now. But it's helpful to realize how complicated this machine is. You see a human being here in front, so this is a gigantic detector. And that detector is only one part of an even more gigantic apparatus, the Large Hadron Collider. It's arguably one of the most complicated machines that humanity has ever built. And why did we build that? With the purpose of measuring the mass of the Higgs boson. Now we'll do a thought experiment. Let's assume for a while that you are not scientists, but managers. And even more, you are the manager who has to oversee the building of that gigantically complex machine. If you do that, if you are really that manager, you will be confronted with a special kind of people, business consultants. So one day you are approached by a consultancy company which calls themselves TDF, the Delusion Factory, and they make you a proposal. They say, well, you are spending billions of euros in building this LHC, but we can save you a lot of money. We have made in our company a protocol that can transform every complex physics machine into a much more simpler device. Into a device that is really trivial and that will give you the same answers than this complex machine. We can convert your LHC into this simple electrical device. And if you now measure the voltage across these two points, the reading on your voltmeter will be the mass of the Higgs boson. And our protocol guarantees that the answer will really be the same as the one from the big machine. There is no loss of information. We are still in our thought experiment. You are the managers. So what will you do to the people of this consultancy company? You look like a good manager. What would you do to these people?
I don't have any idea, because I'm not a good manager.
Well, let me tell you what a good manager would do. He would kick them out of his office, because that is obviously rubbish what they are trying to sell you. This cannot be true. Nevertheless, if you have followed the line of thought of that story, you know exactly what is happening in DFT. So let's repeat that story, but now from the point of view of DFT. The very complex machine we have here is our many-body Schrödinger equation. The protocol that converts the complex machine into the simple machine is now not the TDF company, but density functional theory. It does exactly that. It transforms this very complex Schrödinger equation into a set of single particle equations, these Cohn-Sham equations, which are almost trivial to solve. We know how to do that. There are mathematical methods or numerical methods to solve these Cohn-Sham equations. They go by names like the LAPW method, the PAW method, grid-based methods. And we have computer codes in which these methods are implemented, like the VASP code, the quantum espresso code. And this machinery can solve these Cohn-Sham equations. It's almost as simple as reading the voltmeter. So by doing that, we can take any solid we want, put it into the DFT machinery, and we solve the Cohn-Sham equations, and we have all predictions we want about that solid. Problem solved. Now I'm waiting until somebody tries to kick me out of this room, because this also sounds too good to be true. This cannot happen, otherwise there would be no problem in computational physics anymore. So what is the catch? Where did we miss something in the story? That's this famous exchange correlation functional. Density functional theory can make this transformation, and you can prove mathematically that this is an exact transformation. There is really no information loss in that process, provided you know one single mathematical object, this exchange correlation functional, that is without that one, you cannot make the transformation. And DFT tells us that that single mathematical object exists, but it doesn't tell us how it looks like. It would be comparable to the consultancy company again. They could say, well, we can make this transformation, but there is one resistor in our circuit for which we don't know the value. You have to guess that the value of that resistor. And then, of course, that will compromise the reading on your voltmeter, and the predictions of your simple model will be worthless. So that is the practical catch for density functional theory. We have to find some expression which initially will really be a guess for that exchange correlation functional. That was my first attempt to explain DFT. Second attempt, here we will make the comparison to classical mechanics. Let's take a very simple problem in classical, well, not a simple problem, but a basic problem in classical mechanics, the behavior of our solar system. We have the sun and a series of planets, and we want to describe the time evolution of that system. If it would be only the Earth and the sun, that is a problem that can be analytically solved. And in your physics education, you have probably found that exact analytical solution. That was the contribution of Newton. As soon as you add an extra particle to the problem, say the influence of the presence of Jupiter on the motion of the Earth, then your problem has no analytical solution any longer. Two-body problems can be analytically solved. Three and more body problems can only be numerically solved. So the complicating fact is this planet-planet interaction. It's the interaction between Jupiter and the Earth that makes this problem mathematically so much less convenient. What would happen if we would apply DFT to something as the solar system? How would that look like? Well, DFT would tell us, switch off first the interaction between the planets. That's the complicated thing. So let's go to a system where the planets are not interacting with each other, only with the sun. Of course, that solar system would be different from the real solar system, and we want to describe the real solar system. So we have to correct somehow for that. And we do that by adding an external gravitational field of a very complicated shape that corrects for the omitted planet-planet interaction. And density functional theory guarantees us that such an external field can be found. Even more, density functional theory guarantees us that there exists some generator for that magical field. There is one mathematical object. If you feed in the information for the solar system, you get the field you need to correct for the omitted planet-planet interaction. If you would feed it with the information for a different solar system, near to another star, you would get another external field, but suitable for that particular solar system. So there is only one thing you need to know, this universal generator, and then you can describe any solar system you want. And if I now translate that statement to atoms, molecules, solids, you find something that will probably sound already familiar now to you. You take your crystal, you replace the interacting electrons in that crystal by imaginary electrons that are not interacting with each other, only with the nuclei. And you apply an external field called the exchange correlation field to correct for this omitted interaction. And density functional theory tells us that there exists such a universal generator for that exchange correlation field, which is then again this exchange correlation functional. Tell me the functional and I make any prediction you want without accuracy loss. That was the second way the second attempt to explain DFT. Third attempt. Now we will focus on electron density. I told you about the wave function. We have found the domain and the target set for the wave function, R6 to C. I ask you now the same question for the electron density. Again, for two spinless particles. What is the domain set? What is the target set? And you get, again, four possibilities. You may think about this. Who votes for A, B, C, and D? So I have roughly one-third of the room for B, one-third of the room for D, and a few scattered answers for A and C. So the majority agrees that the target sets are the real numbers. There is some discussion about the domain set, R6 or R3. Well, let's make the connection between the density and the wave function, and then we will see what is the right answer. In quantum physics, observable properties are expressed as an expectation value of some operator. So if I want to express the density in terms of the wave function, I need an operator that will give me the density. And I've written for a one-particle system the expression of that operator there. It's a Dirac delta. Don't mind about the details, but visually the message is that if you take the expectation value of that operator and you just follow the rules of wave mechanics, you find a property here, which is the probability density to find that particle at that position r. And that is just, apart from a factor, the charge density of that system. So that is the way how a density is connected to a wave function. Now, a density, the probability to find a particle at a position in space, what is the argument of that density? What is the object that goes here? That's a vector, a position vector. So 3 degrees of freedom, R3. It doesn't matter how many particles there are in the system. I don't ask about the particles, I ask about the position. What is the probability to find any of the particles at that position in space? So your domain set is R3 for any system. With 2, with 7, with 1 billion particles, it starts from R3. So the correct answer here was D. You go from a position in space to a probability, so a real number, even one between 0 and 1, a real number, not a complex number. So the many-body wave function starts from R to some high power and goes to C. The density starts from R3 and goes to R. So in many respects, it's a much simpler object than the wave function is. Next question for you. So you saw on this slide how that complex, rich wave function is reduced into the much simpler function, the density. Now I ask your feeling about what is the possible information loss? When we transform the wave function into the density, has that density now less information than the wave function? The same amount of information as the wave function? Or more information than the wave function? 3 possibilities. Make your choice. A. 1, 2, 3, 4 people vote for A. B, slightly more than 1/2 of the room. C, nobody for C. Well, you heard the answer already before the coffee break. there is as many information in the density than there is in the wave function. So B is the right answer, which is very counterintuitive. If you didn't have heard the part before the coffee break, or if you never had a course where density functional theory was treated, you would never have guessed that B was the right answer. The density is so much simpler, and yet it contains the same amount of information as that much more complex wave function. That is what is claimed by the first theorem of Hohenberg and Kohn. And I will slowly go through that theorem, not because it will tell us now anything new, but because the conceptual argumentation is so nice. I want to share that. But before I'm able to do that, I need to define mathematically what a functional is. We have already reminded ourselves about the definition of a function. Now we will need the concept of a functional. Functions was between numbers and numbers, say from R to R. A functional is a map between a space of functions and a number, a complex or a real number. And that may sound complicated, but you know many examples of functionals. A very simple one, I could take whatever space of functions and make the functional that connects every function to its value at zero. You can take many different functions, plug them in here, you will get many different or sometimes the same values here at the right. That's one example of a functional. Or you could plug the function into that integral here, and the value after the integration would be the value of the functional. So functionals can be perfectly defined. You can make an entire calculus based on functionals. You can express how to make derivatives of a functional, and so on. There is a whole branch of mathematics dealing with that. Now we go back to our general solid with these five different types of energies. I will omit a few of them, which is that Born-Oppenheimer approximation about which you heard before. I will fix the positions of the nuclei in space. That means they do not move. They have no kinetic energy. The first set of terms gets out. And if they are fixed in space, then their Coulomb interaction with each other is a fixed number. So if it doesn't change, if that number doesn't change, it doesn't affect our solution, and we can just calculate it once and add it later to our calculated energies. So we are left with three terms: kinetic energy of the electrons, the electron-electron interaction, and the electron-nucleus interaction. And only in one of these three sets of terms, the positions of the nuclei appear. Namely here, in the electron-nucleus interaction. That's the only place where we define which type of problem we are solving. Whether we are dealing with a water molecule or BCC iron, that's defined here by these positions of the nuclei. In the context of DFT, this term is often called the external potential. External, because the nuclei give the Coulomb potential in which the electrons move. And they define the type of problem we are solving. Now I will make a few maps. I will start from the set of all possible external potentials. So you can imagine this as all possible molecules and solids that can ever exist. And I make a map to an intermediate set here, which is the wave function. That is the solution of a Schrödinger equation with that particular external potential. This map, of this set in the middle, is not the set of all wave functions. It is the set of all wave functions that are the solution of a Schrödinger equation with one of these external potentials. So the set is smaller than the set of all wave functions. And by defining it that way, that map, let's call it C for a while, that map is a surjective map. Surjective, if you remember about set theory, surjective means that for every member of the target set, there is at least one arriving arrow. There can be more than one arriving arrow, like here, but there should be at least one. Then we make a second map, D, where we connect every wave function to the density, in the way that I described a few slides ago. And again, our set here of densities is the set of densities that correspond to any of these wave functions. Not the set of all densities, but the set of densities that corresponds to any of these wave functions. Therefore, also that map is a surjective map. Now we will wonder, are these maps also injective? And injective in set theory was the situation where at most one arrow is arriving in a member of the target set. Either zero or one, but never two. So if we wonder whether map C is an injective map, that means that we are wondering whether these dashed arrows are allowed or not. Now let your physical intuition work. Can you tell me whether these dashed arrows are allowed or not? What would be the consequences if they are allowed?
That the same wave function could describe more than one system.
Exactly. If that dashed arrow is allowed, then you would have a wave function that is the solution of the Schrödinger equation for two different systems, for two different external potentials. Now, the wave function contains all information that you can ever measure about the solid. So if there would exist such a situation, that would mean that there is somewhere that there are two different solids that by no experiment can ever be distinguished from each other. Which is obviously not possible. If that would happen, we would call these two the same solid. So that situation does not happen. Map C is really an injective map. And you were able to find that out yourself, so this is not a big surprise. The same question about map D. Are there two different wave functions for two different systems that give rise to the same density? And before, a few minutes ago, before having talked about the first theorem of Hohenberg and Kohn, our intuitive answer would probably have been yes, that is probably possible, because we feel that the density is a simpler function than the wave function. But after that first theorem of Hohenberg and Kohn, we realize that however surprising this is not allowed. So this dashed arrow in blue is not possible. A single density corresponds to a unique wave function, and the other way around. Map D is as much as map C an injective map. So the situation we have is this one, and that is essentially in the language of set theory, the first theorem of Hohenberg and Kohn. The proof of that theorem, which is not something we will go through, but the proof of that theorem is actually very simple. So it's on this slide here, and I repeat, we will not go through it, but on this slide you have the complete proof. For a slightly simplified situation, non-degenerate ground states, but nevertheless a complete proof. And it's quite surprising that this is a proof from 1964, that it took more than 30 years of quantum physics before people realized this. So before people realized that you can do quantum physics without a wave function. Having just a density, which contains as many information as the wave function does, is sufficient. You can construct a wave function-free quantum physics, which is density functional theory in some sense. So our maps C and D are surjective and injective, means they are bijective. We have one-to-one relations between any points in these sets. Every solid, every external potential can be uniquely connected to a wave function, and that one can be uniquely connected to a density, which means you can drop out the intermediate step and you can connect the external potentials directly to the density. Instead of expressing a property as an expectation value of an operator in the wave function, you can write it as a functional of the density. The density is a function, so you plug it in into that functional, and the observable property comes out. That is my third attempt to explain density functional theory. So three different ways that each of them highlight a different aspect of DFT, and by taking these three pictures together, I hope you have a good feeling now what DFT means, at least in the conceptual sense. Now we must make the next step and do actual calculations with that. And that is a situation where things are not identical anymore. We will see now in the second, smaller part, three different aspects you have to specify before you can communicate to someone else which type of DFT calculation you have performed. And the first of these aspects is the choice of this exchange correlation functional. Remember the situation. DFT is an exact transformation, provided you know that exchange correlation functional. We don't know it. DFT doesn't give us a recipe for it. So the only thing we can do is making a guess. And you could really call it as bad as a blind guess. In the 60s, people could, I would say, almost randomly take a functional. And then you start to explore what are the predictions if you assume that that functional is correct. And you see in many cases they don't agree at all with experiments, so bad functional. And you keep on going until you find a functional that is behaving well. And behaving well means is predicting the experimental values as closely as possible. It didn't happen historically that way, but I tell it that way because I want to bring across the point that there are no rules for finding functionals. It's really a guess. Now, what was one of the first things that people tried? And really the first thing in 1965, in the original Concham paper, where the Concham method was described, that initial guess was, let's go to one single system that we can solve more or less analytically. A very special solid, a solid that cannot exist in nature, but for which we can write an external potential. I didn't claim that all external potentials in that set should be external potentials you can realize in nature. We can be wider than that. So I take one specific solid where the nuclei are no points. The nuclei are evenly smeared out over space. They completely fill the universe. And then you add electrons to that to neutralize that system. And because there is no structure in the nuclei, there will also be no structure in the electron distribution. You will have a homogeneous isotropic electron distribution. That special solid is called the homogeneous electron gas, or sometimes gallium. And although it doesn't exist, it's a nice tool because we can make manageable calculations for that one. So people calculated in the 70s already the exchange correlation energy for such an homogeneous electron gas. And the only variable you have in the homogeneous electron gas is the horizontal axis on this picture here. That is the density. How many electrons do we have per cubic meter? That's the only degree of freedom that this homogeneous electron gas has. And that's expressed here in somewhat different units, from the high density region at the left to the low density region at the right. So by numerical methods available already in the 70s, people could express the exchange correlation energy for any of these densities. And then you make a leap of faith. You now assume that in a real solid, what is the exchange correlation energy of a real solid? Well, point by point, you scan the unit cell of that solid, and you notice what is the value of the electron density here at that point. Well, this point in space will contribute to the exchange correlation energy as much as a homogeneous electron gas would do with the same density. And you know what the homogeneous electron gas will do, so point by point you can reconstruct the total exchange correlation energy of that solid. That's only a leap of faith, and when Cohn and Sham wrote that down in their initial paper, they didn't believe that this would be anywhere meaningful. They considered it as something that is a nice conceptual tryout, but they didn't hope, and they wrote it explicitly in their paper, they didn't hope that this approximation for the exchange correlation functional, this guess for the exchange correlation functional, that it would anywhere lead to a meaningful description for real solids. Now, the surprise was when people then in the following decades were able to make actual calculations using this assumption, that it did give predictions that were really acceptable. So this local density approximation, which is the name for that guess of the exchange correlation functional, this local density approximation turns out to work quite well in practice. And you can then reason, go backwards and find out, how is this possible? Well, there are many arguments about this. There is some subtle error cancellation between two different approximations in the exchange energy and in the correlation energy that are both completely bad, but these errors cancel each other and the final result is very close to what happens in nature. So you can rationalize why LDA works as good as it does, but the fact that it works as good as it does is the main reason why density functional theory has become a practical method. That was just the initial guess. You can try to improve on that, because now this local density approximation is what mathematicians would call a local functional. You can predict the total exchange correlation energy based on knowing what the density, what the contribution to the exchange correlation energy is in a single point. But you can make this more general, and you can take into account also the neighborhood of that point. So the contribution at that point will depend on the density at that point and the density in the neighborhood. That will be the generalized gradient approximations. You can take kinetic energy contributions into account, and you can go higher and higher up in some hierarchy, which is sometimes called Jacob's ladder, with local density approximation as the first rung of that ladder. So in some of the exercises, when you will work with the B3 lip functional, for instance, that will be one of the higher rungs on that ladder. So much about the first concept you need to specify. You need to tell which exchange correlation functional you have chosen. The second thing you have to specify is the numerical method you use to solve the Cohn-Sham equations. And I will tell a little bit more about that this afternoon. You have heard already a bit about it before the coffee break, when Karen Hemelsu talked about basis sets. So the aspect of basis sets, that is the numerical method. And then the third aspect, you have to specify which computer code are you using. Because numerical methods can be analytically derived, they can be tested, but people still have to implement it in an actual code, and they can make some mistakes perhaps there, or they can make some hidden assumptions there. So it's crucial information to specify what is the tool you used to perform these calculations. And there is a whole zoo of computer codes available for density functional theory, four of them which you will study during this school. So that's an aspect on which I will not elaborate, but you have to realize that it is information that must be communicated. These three aspects, exchange correlation functional, numerical methods, and computer code, these are things you always find in papers that report about density functional theory. So if we go back to the slide from which we started, that short section from a paper that uses DFT, let's now verify whether we really understand all words that appear there. So these calculations are performed within the density functional theory framework. You know by now what density functional theory is. Using the PAW approach, PAW is one of these methods. So one of these solvers for the Cottenier equations. So they specify that aspect here. So PAW approach with the Purdue-Burke-Ernsterhove approximation. That's the choice of the exchange correlation functional in this paper. And this was implemented in the VASP code, which is the third aspect. So these three pieces of information are indeed available in that section of that paper. There are some other technical numbers, and about a few of them I will talk this afternoon. So if I have brought you to the point where you can read that type of information in a DFT paper, then I've reached my goal. Whether you are using DFT calculations yourself or not, whether you have done that before or not, I hope that now you will be able to take any DFT-related paper and at least identify the section where these three different aspects are mentioned. If computational people do not report explicitly on these three different aspects, then you have the right to doubt about their paper. Put it aside. This is really professional conduct that you report these aspects.